Well, we had a lovely few days out on Aegina. Oh, Aegina, sorry. Yeah. So that was lovely. And had a bit of space to process, which was also very good.
It was great.
Yeah, so that was good. How is everyone today? Yeah.
You feel the difference coming back into Athens from out? Is that what you mean? Or?
Yeah.
Dizzy.
Yeah. We still feel like there's a lot of spirit. There's a lot of spirit influence here. And when we have the group, then all those spirits just converge on us and often suppress the... This microphone thing might be a bit of a trouble. We've got these wind socks on, haven't we? See how we go. We can just feel when we were over in the island, it was
Europe has fallen.
Europe has gone. When we were over in the islands, it was a lot less oppressive, you know. So.
I'm feeling much better. I've been you've probably noticed I've been struggling the past, like the last time we met, just with feeling a lot of my own fears being triggered with spirit attack and just I wasn't coping very well with that, and going away really helped. I just was able to connect again and feel and process, and yeah, I feel much more relaxed now, which is lovely. Yeah.
What we wanted to do today is talk to some of those spirits, prefer hopefully. And so those of you who are open to doing that, we're happy to do that with you. Is there any of you who have been prompted to do that today? Or have you been trying to stay away from that? No one's been prompted?
No one's prompted. Is anyone here for the first time? No. Yep.
Oh, okay.
Hi. Do you know what we're up to, or yeah, you had it back.
You've seen some DVDs, or
have you? No.
No? Okay. Just what you've been told. Yeah. No worries. Myself and Mary travel around, talking to people about God and truth and love and things like that. But we also spend a fair bit of time talking to different spirits as well as people on Earth. And today's session, we'd sort of put aside for talking to spirits if some of the people who we know are mediums in the group want to be involved in that, but at the moment they're all shy, so that may not happen. So what would you like to do today, guys?
Sex.
We did last night.
Yeah,
we did.
We were thinking we might dedicate some of Saturday's talk to talk about sex and relationships. Yeah.
So we feel that the topic needs to be given a bit more time than this evening. So we were going to on Saturday talk about love and sex, but talk about the relationship between unhealed emotions and sexual attraction as well. Yeah, we've got to use the microphones, otherwise nobody hears anything. So on Saturday, that's probably what we'll finish up speaking about. We feel that there's quite a lot of pressure on soulmate relationships, or even on relationships, like pressure to break people up rather than have people come together. And we started talking last night about some of the reasons why that was the case, what's going on that causes, with spirit influence in particular, that causes people to separate. So we wanted to probably dedicate a whole afternoon to that topic. Yeah. You want to pass the microphone back?
I wanted to add that I have a question about not meeting a partner, but then I guess that is better to put that on Sunday. I heard you saying that just when I sort of raised my hand. So I can wait.
Yeah. If we're just very, very quickly, if you're not meeting a partner and you think you desire to, then there are emotions coming from you that are preventing that from occurring. So it does get back still to the fact that there are soul-based emotions that are blocking you from joining with a partner. And the key is to identify those soul-based emotions that would be preventing your meeting. And once those of you who are together with a partner, the key is to look at what emotions are preventing you from getting closer and rather influencing you to go further away from each other. Because at the end of the day, love will always bring us together, whereas if we're not loving, it will always finish up separating us. Sometimes it is loving to leave a relationship and be alone, but not due to spirit influencing you to separate. And you'd want to have far deeper reasons than just the fact that you're arguing all the time, because arguments are indicating that both of you or one of you is denying quite large emotions inside of yourself. So, and if we're single, we want to look at the emotional reasons why, if we think we don't want to be single, we've got to look at the emotional reasons why we are. And there's always quite deep, very strong emotional reasons that repel the other gender away from us at some point. So we'd like to talk about those emotions a bit more on Saturday. Yeah.
Yeah.
So I have been working a lot with this issue, and have had a lot of theories what's blocking me and stopping me.
Yeah.
And my last theory is that my soulmate is dead.
Right.
So that was my question also, is because I had an insight that I am in a, or I had that message that I am in a loving relationship with my partner or soulmate, but I am not here in this life, so that added to that theory I have. So that was also something I wanted to ask if you could help me with.
Yeah, because it is possible that our soulmates have passed, obviously if that is the case, then that'd be in the spirit world, but it's very rare that they wouldn't be with us even if they're in the spirit world, because they would be attracted to us unless they feel the emotions repelling them from us, and or that they have particular emotions they are yet to work their way through. But the beauty of the soulmate longing is that there's so much that can be done with it. Do you know what I mean? Like it's such a strong binding force that can help you work your way through many things, but it can also attract your soulmate even when your soulmate's in a totally blocked condition. So even if our soulmate is in the spirit world and in a completely blocked condition, just our developing a longing for our soulmate and having a pure desire for him or her, that will automatically attract that person into our life in the spirit world. In fact, they will feel drawn to be around us constantly without really knowing why, without really understanding why. And so if we don't feel them around us, then there is still blockages coming from our soul towards them. So we should feel them around us in our awake state if they have passed. Does that make sense?
Yeah. It does. I think it's about trusting that that I do feel him around me.
Mm-hmm.
But
yeah. So we can certainly talk to you more about that.
Thank
on
you.
Saturday. Yeah. Yep. Okay. If we can have the microphone over that.
Next
Hi. I don't want to speak about relationships. Well, you'll speak about that on Saturday.
Yeah.
But if it's okay, about an experience I had, and I don't know what it meant. It's a few months ago. I was trying to resolve some issues with my grandma. And I could feel she was very close to me and she was guiding me in some emotions. So that was all going great. And then I was very tired, so I went to sleep. And suddenly, I don't even know if I was in a wake or sleeping state, but I was fully conscious. I felt strong light coming into the room. And I kind of freaked out, basically. So I was kind of opening my eyes and then closing them again, trying to see whether I'm dreaming or not. But it was constantly just becoming brighter, and I felt warmth in my legs, like the heating was on. And then I was like, I don't want to do that. I don't know what that is. So then it just went away. But it was very, very strong. So I don't know what that was.
So what were you thinking about at the time?
I don't know. I just went to bed to sleep, just to relax, because I was crying a lot. And then I just.
So what then made you feel it was your grandmother?
Because I felt I was connected to her, so I thought maybe she's visiting me.
Yes.
I had a dream. I'm not sure if it was that night or the night after. That we were in the kitchen and she came, but she was in a form like she was older, like a grandma. And I was like, oh, what are you doing here? She's like, you told me to come. And then I saw my brother there sitting on the table. So then I had this thought, okay, she's dead. He's alive. Why are we all here? So that freaked me out again. And I just woke up because I couldn't understand why my brother is there, because I was to talk to her.
Yeah.
So that was that.
Yeah, my suggestion is to allow these events to occur and deal with your fears that you have associated with them. A lot of times when what we call sort of almost supernatural type events occurring, and we see them occurring and we feel them occurring, even where somebody is either affecting our body in some way or something like that, and we know that it's a spirit, a lot of the times we become so afraid without feeling whether the spirit is malevolent or benevolent. In other words, whether they feel like a nice person or they feel like a nasty person. And so what we finish up doing is we finish up preventing the experience completely without actually investigating it further. And a lot of our spirit friends who are our friends, who are benevolent or nice to us, often want to communicate with us, but we prevent the communication because we're just as much afraid of their communication as we are of communication from spirits who are nasty to us. And so, unfortunately, what we finish up doing is finish up blocking any good interactions we could be having with the spirit world as a result. So my suggestion, if it happens again, is to just allow the fear to wash over you as a feeling and breathe. Like if you breathe diaphragmatically through your fear, you'll find the fear will wash over you and you'll feel maybe a bit terrified. But you can pray in that moment to God just to keep you nice and safe, but allow the experience to continue and see where the experience takes you. In the case of a benevolent spirit, it will usually take us into an interaction with them where we might be able to even see them or talk to them, and we can talk about all sorts of matters with them. In the case of a malevolent spirit, a spirit is a bit nastier, it'll always trigger an emotion that we're holding on to that we need to release anyway. So either way, it's going to benefit us if we embrace the situation. So that would be my suggestion. I feel it is grandma trying to have some interaction with you, but unfortunately, every time she gets close to having the interaction, you're so afraid by that stage that she feels your fear and goes, oh, you know, it's too afraid, so I'll move away again. Yeah.
Thank you.
I just thought about this. Me and Fiona were talking about it earlier. About putting animals to sleep when they're in pain, it just seems like.
You mean killing animals when they're in pain?
Yeah.
Let's say what it is, shall we?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I've had lots of animals put to sleep over, you know, pets over the years.
Yeah.
And, you know, even like, say, if you hit a rabbit on the road or something and I brought it back and. You know, my partner's got a gun and he'll shoot it. Obviously, yeah. I shoot it. But you know what?
Obviously, when you're at one with God, there will be no accidents that will occur with animals between yourself and animals. And any animal that is your pet will live as long as you do. So, in other words, if you live 100 years, then they'll live 100 years. Because their energy and their emotion, their spirit body responds to your emotions. So if we have animals that are regularly getting sick or having illnesses or accidents around us, that is always related to our emotion. It's related to the emotion of the person who is the most connected to the animal. So if the animal has a specific sort of disease or has a specific sort of illness, it's always related to the emotion of the person towards the animal or the emotion of the person towards themselves that the animal can feel. And so the key with everything first is while it may be, if the animal is in a lot of pain, it may be and there's no way to prevent that pain other than euthanizing the animal, then while we might want to consider that as an option, we also need to face the fact that there is a lot of soul-based things going on from our soul towards the animal for this event to have occurred in the first place. And unless we're willing to face the relationship that's going on between the soul-based events, the events inside of us, the emotional events inside of us that are occurring that affect the animal, then we will not understand. We may finish up euthanizing the animal, but the reality is still not dealing with the emotion. And then we have another pet and we finish up creating the same event again and again and again. We have a lot of friends who actually own farms and in Australia. And one thing they've found is that every single emotion that they're in denial of is automatically reflected in the animals day by day by day. Some of our friends have sheep farms, for example, which have up to 20,000 head of sheep. And they have periods of their farm where they have no deaths on the property at all. No sheep get attacked by wild dogs or anything like that. And then when they start going through certain emotions, what happened recently is they started to deny certain emotions about spirit attack that they were receiving. They had a spate of dog attacks that killed almost 100 of their sheep. So there's a direct relationship every single time between what happens between the animals and the fact that we're in care of them. So the key is to investigate the emotions involved. Now, the way to do that is by firstly feeling the powerless emotions you feel when an accident has occurred and you know the animal is in pain and you know there's nothing you can do to heal the animal and know that it's going to be in pain for a long time that it can't bear. And what do you do about that? And it's often our fear that causes us to revert to euthanizing the animal rather than some other option. With the same friends that I was mentioning, method of actually anesthetizing the animal by using spirits. So what they do is they hold their hands over the animal and they ask for spirits to just anesthetize the animal, and the spirit knocks out the animal, like it just goes out like that without any chemicals or anything like that, just anesthetize the animal. And then one of those persons is a veterinary. What do you call it? A veterinarian.
Yep.
And he repairs the animal as best he's able. And as soon as he's finished the repair job and sewn up the last bit of skin, the animal comes to. And you can also ask spirits to calm the animal as well, like to make it so it's not afraid. But every time an animal is afraid, it is actually reflecting mostly our terror and fear. So we've had people, for example, in Australia, as I mentioned last week, we have a lot of poisonous snakes in Australia. And we had a friend who had a poisonous snake wrapped up in a heap of wire around their house. So it got itself tangled in a heap of wire and it was a poisonous snake, one where if you get bitten by it, you could die within a day or so. It was a king brown snake. And what they did was they went up to it initially, and because she was so afraid of it, the snake became so
agitated
that it started wanting to attack her and everything, like as she was trying to untangle the snake from the fence. And she had to go away and just feel her terror about that. Once she felt her terror about that and let it go, which took her about 15 or 20 minutes, the snake was still in the wire in this time. She went back to the snake, and this time the snake was completely calm, and she managed to unthread and cut away all the wire, and the snake didn't try to attack her at all, didn't try to harm her at all, and then once all the wire had been released, the snake just crawled off, but slithered off after all of that. So the reality is that most of the time, most of the animals and even insects respond to our fears in particular and our rage. So there are two primary emotions that that animals respond to. So if you're having animals pass on you frequently, or pets that pass on you, or you're attracting events involving animal after animal after animal, the key is to always reflect upon the emotion, and particularly the emotions relating to fear that are within yourself as a starting point.
Thank you.
No worries. Effie?
Just quickly, on the same subject, yeah. I had a situation where I was looking after my parents' cat. They went away, and the cat was 18, very old,
yeah.
And they went away, and my mum had been saying for a while, that cat's going to go soon, I just know she's going to go when I'm away.
Yeah.
She left me £200 in case of emergencies,
yeah.
And the next day when Luca and I went to feed the cat, it was fitting and couldn't move its legs, you know, it was completely paralysed and yeah. bringing up blood.
Yeah.
And so I took it to the vet because I couldn't do anything else.
Yeah.
And she said it's got a couple of hours left and it's in a lot of pain.
Yeah.
And I had to make choice.
Yeah.
I had
yeah.
to say, okay. And I just felt like, what's my law of attraction saying there? Because this is my mother. Basically, I felt, you know, like all her emotions. But I had to make the decision.
Yeah, and if you think about it, this is what your mum does a lot with you in your life, is that she forces you into making the unwelcome decisions. You know, with some of the past events in your life, you know, you're having to confront your mother with things that she is wishing to avoid herself, and then she blames you for the for making the choice or decision, but she's always forcing you into making the unwelcome decisions. And so the key is to go through that emotion. So the event is just to trigger that emotion. The cat itself and its sickness and illness and the knowing that mum knowing that it would pass when she's away was really mum desiring that it passes while she's away. Do you understand? Like,
yeah, because she thanked me. Like when yeah. I told her, she's like, thank you so much for doing that for me.
Yeah, because...
You know? And the vet said, this cat's been sick for a long time.
Exactly. Yeah, the reality is your mum avoids a lot of situations, as you know, that are very, very confronting emotionally, and places those situations in your hands, and then you're left to deal with the after effects of them. The key is to go through that emotionally, to let yourself feel the emotion of that, how that constantly gets placed into your hands. The reality is, as you say, the cat itself is going to reflect mum's condition, but mum probably had a knowing that it was going to happen. Obviously, giving you £200 just for going away for the cat, obviously she had a very strong feeling that it was going to happen, and also perhaps a desire for it to happen at the time. And that is demonstrating how much she's imposing her desire for you to sort out her problems for her. And if you think about it, she's done that a lot of your life. Yeah, wants you to sort out her problems for her. Yeah. And the animal is just... the unfortunate thing with our animals is that they are in this whirlpool of emotion from the human race. You know, like they're just... There's so many emotions, and every single animal on the planet responds to the emotions of the human race, even wild animals. But every animal that is a pet is a direct connection with its owner and has a direct connection with its owner's denied emotions. So, you know, if anything is wrong with an animal, it's always good for us to... have a very good reflection, you know, on what particular thing I'm denying for this animal to experience this particular thing.
I recently got a dog back that I hadn't had for 5 years, and when we got it back, I was in the middle of some emotions about attack.
Yeah.
And every time I took it for a walk, just me, it got ticks
yeah.
all over it, its yeah. female side.
Yeah.
And whenever Mike took it, it didn't get any ticks.
Right, yeah.
And then I was processing, and then it stopped.
Yeah.
And Biggie didn't get any ticks when I took him out for a walk.
Right.
It was incredible.
Yeah. Yeah. And this is the thing, even insects attacking our pets are even related to our own emotions as well. So, and you'll see a direct correlation between masculine-based emotions, feminine emotions, you know, whether we feel fear attack or whether we're angry or any of those kind of emotions, there is always a direct relationship between what's happening to the animal And so it's very specific, and it's also very unique to every situation. So this is where we need to feel our emotions involved with the animal. Yeah. Nicole? There's a mic down here. One's going to get you first.
I was in a big conflict when I had like my two female cats spayed. And because I truly believe...
Can we explain what that is?
Oh, sorry,
because
yes.
Because a lot of people overseas don't know what
to
that is.
To neuter or to spay them means that you have an operation that they can't have babies anymore either. Like, yeah.
Like a hysterectomy.
So you
like a hysterectomy.
So de-sex them, basically.
Yeah.
You take away their reproductive organs.
Yeah. Right. Yeah, so I was in a big conflict if I should do this or not, but I really didn't want my two female cats to have babies because I didn't want to obviously put up with the babies. I know it's my issue, but then I was wondering, at the same time I was wondering, okay, there's so many cats here around, they hardly have space to live. They live in the from the garbage of the garbage bins.
Mm-hmm, they do. Particularly here in Greece, then you've got dogs and cats doing
exactly.
that.
Exactly. Mm. And there's so many that are so thin and they struggle to survive somehow. So I was then wondering, is it now loving or unloving to neuter or to spay them, to have them spayed?
This question really is a much bigger question than most people realise, because the reality is we're asking questions about the cats or dogs that are in our own home or around us, but the reality is a lot of the reason for it has to do with the lack of care humanity has towards animals generally.
Yeah.
The reality is that there are quite a lot of different emotions affecting our domesticated animals. For example, most women on this planet have a feeling inside of them that they're not really a woman unless they've had a child. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. There's a very, very strong pressure from, particularly from older generation to the next generation, that until you've had a child, particularly for a woman, until you've had a child, you really don't know what it means to be a mother, and therefore you really don't know much about life. There's this sort of feeling that is projected at the next generation. Now, for that reason, many women start menstruating very, very early, and then as a result of that, continue menstruation throughout much of their, what would normally be their productive reproductive life. And the only reason why they're really menstruating is because their body is continually preparing every single month for a baby, basically. Now God didn't create things that way. God created the woman would prepare, woman's body would prepare for a child when the woman herself had a pure desire for a child to come. And then her body would prepare for the child to come. Now, the reality is that the emotions being projected at children, and particularly at women, from such a young age are so great that by the time they're 12 or 13 years of age, they already feel they need to have a child in order to prove their worth. And that is a hidden emotion that is within most women throughout the rest of their life. Now, can you see? That also has a link to what happens with our animals. So many of our animals that are associated with us, particularly domestic animals, are constantly also getting into this state where they're being ready for reproduction all the time. Whereas our animals also have the ability to respond to our desire of whether we would like the animals to have children, to have progeny or not. You know, so the reality is the animals themselves can also respond to our desire with regard to whether we would like them to have babies or not. And as a result, we can actually, through our desire, affect whether the animal does have babies or not, and ever gets pregnant, in fact. Now, most people, of course, don't believe this is the case. And so what we finish up doing is we finish up taking a physical action, which is, you know, de-sexing the animal, in order to prevent the pregnancy. And ironically, we also take the same action with ourselves. We take some kind of contraceptive, or we take some kind of permanent solution that prevents us from having children. So because we don't want children, but the reality is in the soul, there is the injury in the soul dictating how the body will react. And so it's really good to start looking at the emotions associated with reproduction and what kind of values as a human society we place upon people who have had children in comparison to people who have not, and what kind of whether we would, you know, what kind of values we place in terms of whether we would listen to them even. So let's say a person with no children started talking about having children to a person that's already had children, what would be the general response? Yeah. Well, you know, the general response, what can you tell me about? You've never had children, so what can you tell me about all that? You can't tell me anything about that. And there's this general feeling towards the person that unless you've gone through the event, then you can't tell me anything about bringing up children or anything else. And there is also a degree of value that's placed upon the having of the child. If you think about it multi-generationally, there's many emotions associated with having children as a way of ensuring your own longevity. Does that make sense? Like the family chain, if you like, through history. And this is why historically, if you look at most civilizations on the planet, historically there's been a huge emphasis on whether the woman is barren or not, whether the woman is able to have children or not. And if she isn't able to have children, then discard her and go and find another woman who can have children.
Not even just children, but male children.
Yeah.
Just reading the book, The Red
Tent. Yeah, that's right, yeah. So there is a real focus even on the male children rather than the female children, and still in many civilizations.
Commonly,
and still even here.
Yeah.
It's very much in vogue, isn't it? If you've got a man around, then of course there's the security for the so-called security for the family. And all of these emotions are imposed upon the woman, and then the woman then starts feeling like she must become a person who can have children but also have male children and so forth. And if she doesn't do that, then she feels terrible feelings of lack of worth.
Yeah, the worth. A lot of women's worth is tied up in this ability to become a mother. And that's a very deep multi-generational injury. And so obviously our bodies are totally always responding to that injury, whether we're going, I don't want to have kids, I'm not ready, whatever. The injury is, I'm not, my worth is linked to my ability to have kids. My worth, you know, I'm not a real woman unless I do.
So unless we're willing to feel that unworthy feeling about not having them, we will have the body will automatically respond at wanting to produce children, whether we want it to or not. Now, what I'm illustrating in this question is the relationship between those emotions projected at the woman, but then also those emotions from the woman projected then at all of the animals that are surrounding her, including in particular the domesticated animals that surround her. So if she has cats or then those same emotions will be imposed upon those animals. And so us taking the action to have the animal de-sexed doesn't really deal with the cause of why the animal is continually reproducing. And so it's one thing to deal with the effect, which sometimes is a wise thing to do because we don't know what else to do. Yeah. But it is far better for us to actually begin also to address the causes as to why these things continually occur.
I saw this one cat, that adopted me basically.
Yep.
She was in the beginning when I didn't have her yet and I hadn't had her spayed yet. She was sitting outside and there were literally five males around her, lingering around her for hours until one would finally jump on her.
So now just stop for a moment.
Yeah.
Feel about that. Yeah. Well, how does that feel to watch that as a woman? When you women feel about that, there's these five men surrounding this one female cat, five male cats surrounding this one female cat, just waiting for an opportunity to have sex with it. Like, what do you feel when you in your own life? Like, how does that feel for your own life? See, every event is a law of attraction event for us. So the fact that I'm watching this means that I've got something going on emotionally with this. Does that make sense? And so I would start looking at how you feel about men, like how you feel that men are just wanting to, you know, just basically they're
predatory,
just waiting, they're predatory, waiting for a female to be just open to having sex, and then once they have sex, then they just leave the woman to look after her own babies. That's often what happens, isn't it, on the planet? And a lot of women have a lot of rage and anger, and also fear and sadness, of course, about those particular events. So that if I was watching such an event and I was a woman watching such an event, that would be the first emotion that I'd be looking at connecting with. Because that is actually a law of attraction event created for to help me trigger myself in this emotion, to work through that emotion. Make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah. We were saying to some of our friends who have a lot of animals that once we work through all of our intergender emotional injuries, you know how on the planet most male animals are very aggressive sexually. The reason why most male animals are very aggressive sexually is because most males, humans on the planet, are very aggressive sexually.
And
does that make sense? There's a relation, direct relationship between that and the humans and the animals.
And most women have a lot of anger also about that issue. So that adds to the issue.
Yeah. So you see, for example, with sheep, one ram will inseminate like 100 ewes. Whereas once, and you can't keep the ram in with the ewes even after they've been impregnated, because if you do, the ram will just keep going at them and going at them. Like, what does that sound like?
Raping.
But what does it sound like in terms of the humans with regard to, isn't that what many men are like, really? You just, many men will continue, you know, desiring, you just have sex and they still want more. And there's emotions involved in that. And these emotions are being imposed upon the animals, and so therefore the animals are responding in the they're reflecting back at the human race our unhealed condition.
Mm.
Yeah. And so we need to start addressing that emotionally. But the majority of us, of course, are totally ignoring of that. And in fact, what we do is we do almost the opposite. We go and almost justify completely, like a male's overt sexual
behavior.
Mm. We justify it completely. Most men will say, no, but I'm a male, you know, and I'm allowed to look where I've got needs, you know, and so forth, and not looking at all at the underlying emotional reasons why it's going on. Mm. Yeah.
Thank you.
So there's always a relationship between what happens with the animals and what happens in humanity at large, but also for us personally. So if we have domestic animals or animals that are attracted to us, then what we need to do is we need to consider the relationship between that animal being attracted to us and what injuries the animal seems to have, and therefore a reflection on the injuries that I have. Does that make sense to everyone? Have you given that much thought before? Like the relationship between the animals and what's happening to the animals, and there's really direct correlations, hey?
Mm.
And like most women looking at a situation where there's five male cats surrounding a female cat, most women would be very upset with the male cats, yes? So feel that anger that's there and go deeper into the, you know, into the fear of being sexually attacked and all those kind of feelings, yeah. Is that all right?
Thank you.
All right. Is that the end of the animal questions? Just hang a sec if we have a mic there.
I was always wondering why men are like this. It cannot be only because of the reason of reproduction.
It's not.
It's not at all.
Why are they so inconsiderate? I do not understand that.
Most men have huge amounts of sadness.
You mentioned that yesterday.
Yep, and the reality is the way they try to address this sadness is not by crying. So they really need to cry, but they don't want to cry because you look at all the beliefs of society about a man crying.
Many of them held by women.
Yeah, most women even have those beliefs about a man crying. So most women don't want... You know, if there was a stressful situation, most women don't want the man to cry. They want the man to sort it out. You know, the woman's all right to cry for the stressful situation, but the man has to sort it out. And so most men are taught not only by their fathers but also by their mothers that they're not allowed to cry. Now, in the process of not crying, most men have huge amounts of grief associated with...
Lack of...
They have huge amounts of grief associated with a lack of love coming from the feminine. The reality is, on the planet at this point in time, there is no divine feminine on the planet at this time. And there never has been on this planet from right from the time of Ammon and Amman. As a result of that, there is a huge misunderstanding about what femininity is on the planet. And as a result of that, most men feel that lack of femininity in their own lives, but, and they feel very sad about it. But instead of crying about it, most men want to be angry about it.
May I ask you, what does it mean, femininity? You said there is a lack of femininity.
Yep.
Oh, I think I'm feminine. Or
I know you think
person,
you are.
But still, I don't know when you mentioned that.
Can I put to you, firstly, can you feel the amount of rage in you towards the male?
No.
So the fact is any male around you can feel that. So I can feel it from you.
You can feel the rage.
Yeah, towards
think back
the male.
To when you asked.
Think
you
about
just
the question
asked the
you
question.
Just asked.
The feeling, there was a lot of rage in the question. Yeah. Why are men like that? You know, I feel angry about the fact that men are like this.
Yeah. I remember the situation. I remember the situation and I remember why I asked this question. I've been once exposed to such inconsideration.
Yes.
And didn't know how to escape from this inconsideration.
Yes.
So I agree there is a lot of rage.
Exactly, yeah. Exactly.
Okay.
Now, what would happen if you had a male child?
I don't know.
Can you see the male child would feel the anger towards the men that is still within the soul, still within you?
I assume so.
Yeah. So in the process of them feeling it, what would the male child do with it? You know, for a start, he's just a child. He's not been a part of damaging your life. But just because he's a male, he's automatically condemned. Does that make sense? So as he's growing up, he's automatically condemned by the woman because he's a male. There's this feeling coming from the woman towards him. He's either got to be the ideal man. In other words, he's got to be perfect now, the opposite to all the men that she's had in her past. Or he's just going to be the same mongrel that every other man has been, you know, the same.
So he receives that. He receives a projection from the mother. If you're different from all the other horrible men, then you're all right.
Yep.
But that's a very conditional kind of love then, isn't it?
Yeah.
Or, oh, you're just like all the other men. And so that's a rejection almost.
Yeah.
I understand. So... Now, the lack of femininity.
Do you want to finish that? And then I'd love to talk about the femininity thing.
The femininity thing, myself and Mary would like to speak of over a series of days, actually, because there's a lot involved in it. And it's very hard to give you a clear answer in a very short time frame because there is so much involved with this femininity issue and masculinity too, by the way. The two areas of masculinity and femininity are totally, you know, most people, well, most Greek men, for example, would view themselves as masculine, whereas the reality is most men on the planet are actually more overtly arrogant than masculine. In other words, they think arrogance is masculine, but actually arrogance is not masculine or feminine. It's an injury. It's an emotional injury.
The divine or the pure expression of both masculinity and femininity doesn't have any unloving qualities. So arrogance is an unloving projection, just like a lot of rage that women carry is not a feminine quality at all.
Nor is it a masculine one.
No.
It's actually
an
injury.
It's an injury, yeah. But with regards to femininity, last night I think you were there and I was talking about how... in the relationship with men, a lot of women are operating in this space of demand. They have a lot of grief and fear and anger, fear and grief about men and masculinity that they're carrying. And that's a lot of pain that they carry in their soul. But to avoid that pain, I observe most women, including myself, especially when I first met AJ, living in this space of demand with men. And other women, a demand, an expectation that especially men help me avoid all this grief and sadness. So I'll enter a relationship with you as long as you don't trigger any of my shame, fear or grief. And we're supposedly feminine. And I put to you that that's not a feminine quality at all, this demand. And actually we live most of our life in relationships in this state of expectation and demand. And from my point of view, I cannot express my feminine self while I'm living in those spaces, because femininity just like masculinity, but to be truly in my feminine expression, I'm in a state of giving and nurturing without an expectation of return. Now, when I have a demand and an expectation, and that is the basis for all of my relationships, I'm not even touching femininity. I'm living in addiction. And so these beautiful qualities of femininity are smothered even underneath my fear, grief and shame. They're living in another space. And we might see glimmers of them here and there, but really while we live in anger and expectation and demand, it can't be an expression of my soul. And it does not exist anywhere, because there's no woman yet at one with God on the planet. So there's no woman living without any addiction, really. And many of us are living in a great deal of addiction. And there's lots I'd like to say about it. You're right. I need to maybe have a talk about it.
Yeah. It's a very true masculinity and true femininity are both pretty very important subjects, actually. Yeah. And a lot of times what we view today as masculine or feminine has nothing to do with masculinity or femininity, but it has everything to do with emotional injuries that we carry.
Yeah, I understand that. Yeah. So I was wondering if you know what femininity would mean. I would like to go there then.
Yeah, we would like to describe that in a lot of detail as to what it is, and also what masculinity is too.
Yeah.
Rather than accepting the world's definition of them. So today, for example, the world sort of defines masculinity as sort of almost arrogant, self-assured confidence, but it's very arrogant and demanding towards the woman generally. But none of those things are masculinity either. They're all just emotional injuries. Can I just address a little subtext that's happening, though, for us as a group at the moment?
Yeah.
With the
neighbour
who is doing the work. What do you feel is happening? Yeah. But who's influencing him? There's somebody influencing him.
His wife.
There's spirits who are angry with us influencing him. Does that make sense? So if you can just feel, rather than deny the attack upon you as a group, like if we, rather than deny the attack or get us upset with the attack upon us, if we can just settle with the emotion, yes, we are getting attacked here, we are being told we're not welcome, from the spirits who are around, just let yourself feel that emotionally together. Do you understand? If we all feel that emotionally, then those spirits no longer have the power to influence this man. Do you understand? And from that moment on, he'll feel more a desire to be more considerate automatically. Does that make sense? So if we can focus on, instead of feeling like, oh, it's annoying, isn't it frustrating, we have this interrupting us and so forth, if we can focus on the fact, yes, we are getting a form of attack, yes, it is coming from spirits and manipulation from spirits, and yes, what we need to do is just feel about it and feel what we feel about it. Now, some of you are feeling angry about it at the moment, right? So the key is to feel the anger about it and then go into why you feel angry about it.
Remember on, I think it was Saturday, we talked about a channeling that we'd done with our guides that talked about the major issue for most of us who are wanting to connect with God and feeling a lot of spirit pressure against us is this feeling like we're at war, we're in a battle with this spirit attack. And they talked to us about actually finding a space of love with these spirits. Now, the only way we can do that is to soften into the feelings that are brought up within us when we receive the attack or we receive the opposition. So if somebody's like wanting to pressure me or oppose me and I go into a state of stop it and resisting, I immediately add to the exchange.
And
increase the actual hook into the spirit. If I can soften under the weight of it, it feels like we're trained from when we're so tiny that's a state of powerlessness and that's weak. But actually, that humble state, we're much more in connection and it lessens their impact, their ability to impact on us. So
the feeling I have is I'd love to have a chat with those spirits. I'd love to have a talk with them and find out why they're so upset, you know, and find out what's the reason for the influence, you know. Whereas most of us would have a feeling of, like, I just want them to go away. I just want them to get lost, you know, to go and leave us alone type of feeling, you know. And, yeah, it's important to notice the dynamic of what's going on around us like that. Nico, would you like the mic? Thank you. It's on.
I would like to ask what happened after my father decided to leave regarding with my mother. What kind of emotions, and not only from my mother, but also from my grandfather, her father, on me.
Yep. You're asking about your personal emotional condition, Nico?
No.
No.
I mean...
You're asking about the emotions affecting your mother, not you.
No. The emotions after my father decided to go, the emotions projected upon me that are part of me now.
Yep.
The false beliefs.
Yep.
I found some. It has to do with my masculinity.
Yeah.
But they are really hard to penetrate and to pinpoint, you know?
And how blunt do you want me to be with you?
Totally.
Totally, okay. All right, after your father left, your mother started viewing you as the ideal man. But to view you as the ideal man, she also has this injury that she has to do everything for you. So the, one of the big injuries that you have now is that you expect women to do everything for you. And in fact, your mother has prevented you from growing up. She's caused you to remain a child through this interaction. So you have quite a high degree of expectation of your environment, in the sense that you expect people in your environment to do things for you, to fit into your life. You expect to get everything how you want it to be. And this is one reason why you keep saying, I don't like that. You know, like, one reason why you keep saying you don't like things is because you're almost like a child having a tantrum about everything that's wrong. You know, so, oh, I don't like that, and I don't like that, and I don't like that. Nothing's suiting me now. Now that you're an adult, you're attracting all these different events that you don't like, and you're acting, in a way, you're acting like a child in response to them. And the child's way of acting is, I don't like that, somebody's got to fix it for me. Somebody else has to do the fixing, not me. And so your mum, through her projections, has caused you to have this belief system that you have an expectation that somebody else sort it all out for you, and preferably that somebody else be a woman, and not a man, but a woman. This has caused you to detune from your desire to take full responsibility for your own life and your desire to be a grown man. And so what happens in many of your interactions is you're waiting for the other person to tell you what you should do or to do it for you, rather than you taking control of your personal life and actually doing it for yourself. You can still do it lovingly, but do it for yourself rather than waiting for women or other people to do it for you. Also, it causes you to feel that the woman is responsible for your emotions. And so this is one reason why when we speak of an emotion to you, there's this, oh, I don't like that either. You know, you know it's a truth inside of you, but you don't want to have to deal with that particular emotion emotionally, because you don't want to take responsibility for the fact that this emotion is within you now. So the key for you, Nico, I feel, is to allow yourself now. Your mother wants to keep you a child, and it's interesting. I feel you're still living at home, aren't you, with her? Yep. She wants you around as a replacement male for the lost relationships that she has. And so she wants to keep you as her child, but she also wants you to be the man around the house, so she can have some male interaction. And so until you separate from your mum, and I don't mean separate physically, I mean separate emotionally from your mum, it's going to be very, very difficult for you to firstly grow up and be a man in your own right, looking after yourself, caring for yourself. But it's also going to be very, very difficult for you to connect to a woman who wants to have an equal relationship with you. In other words, it's not very sexy having to, for a woman, having to be your caretaker, you know?
Emotionally.
Mm. That's not something that most women find very attractive. And it's only a woman who would desire to control you who might find that attractive. In other words, it's only a woman like your mother who might find that attractive. And I suggest to you that you don't want to enter a relationship with a woman who's like your mother if you can help it, because in the end of the day, it's not going to help you grow any more than what your mother has helped you grow. So the key I feel for yourself is to allow yourself to see that the feeling you have that makes you attracted to some of the methods that you use to tune out of your emotions. For example, you know how you smoke cigarettes still and you still need that coffee in the morning to get you going and to detune a little bit and feel normal. And those kind of addictions are just masking quite a lot of sadness in these very contrary demands that your mother is placing upon you. And she's placing one, you know, a lot of demands she's placing upon you are to be a child still. And then, you know, she doesn't want you to grow up. And she'd have big arguments with you, actually, when you do grow up. She basically, every time you want to do your own thing, she will then argue with you. And this is one reason why you've been attracted to go to sea. Because when you're at sea, you're surrounded mostly by males. And you don't have to deal with the heavy projections of a mother dictating to you what you should be as a man, but on the other hand, there's this strong desire in you to grow up and actually take full responsibility emotionally for your entire life, and as a result of that, there's a kickback for you. Having mum look after you is sort of like a kickback for you, you know, that's what you're looking for. You want the woman to look after you and care for you so that you don't have to take responsibility and care for yourself.
What is the most loving way to trigger a situation so I can finally cut the cord?
It's going to require, Nico, having firstly a desire to feel and take responsibility for your life. At the moment, you have this desire that a woman takes responsibility for your life. And every time a woman disappoints you, you act like a sort of like a spoiled child with her. So in other words, like if you have a bit of a tiff or an argument and you don't get what you want, you then go, all right, that's it, not seeing you anymore, you know, scrub you out of my life, that's the way it's going to be, I'll scrub you out of all of my life. And then, you know, 5 days later, you still want her, really, here, but you're just doing that in order to try to control and manipulate her into an action. To punish her. Mm. So you're not actually taking responsibility for the fact that you don't really want to get rid of her out of your life. You don't really want to exclude her from your life, but you're doing it in order to control her and force her into changing her actions with you.
Can I add to that, babe? Yeah. Nico, I feel it's really important to look. Remember I was speaking earlier about women and the demands we have on men and how unless we're willing to relinquish our demands, we're never actually going to get to our true pain. I feel for yourself it's very similar. At the moment, you're not wanting to see how much demand and expectation you have on a woman to help you avoid your emotional self. So that's the place to start. Mm. How much do I expect the women in my life to make me feel okay about myself? And is that really a loving thing? If I want that so much, does God want that? Does God want me to always be dependent on a woman in order to feel myself, to connect to Him? No, hey? So that's, I would start there. At the moment, there's a lot of, you're so entrenched in it, you don't notice. And if you're really going to access the true grief with your mum, you're going to have to firstly see what is the addiction that I have in place that helps me avoid this.
Because at the moment, you like how this is with your mum. Like, so otherwise, you wouldn't stay there, would you? You know, if you think about it, you wouldn't stay living with your mother if you didn't like something about it. Right? And so the key is to look at the emotional, what do you like emotionally? What does she give you emotionally that no other woman gives you at this point? Do you follow me? And that's the addiction. And until you face that addiction and actually want to see it and do something about it, you're not going to be able to enter a relationship with any other woman, because the primary relationship is going to be this relationship with your mother, dictating what's going to happen to you in your life.
So it's not really loving for me to go on a trip that I was planning.
I can't comment on about what's loving for you or what's not loving for you. You need to feel about that more. You know, one of the things that myself and Mary are often expected to do is sort of rule on issues of whether it's loving or not. And what we're trying to do is help each person to become personally responsibility.
Because it has to do with my responsibility.
Exactly.
And that's
and
that's
in fact, your
the main
question
issue.
Is
yeah.
one of the
yeah.
issues.
Yeah.
The fact that you're wanting me to tell you what's loving.
Yeah,
is actually
that's unloving.
Yeah. Yeah, well, it's actually a part of the addiction you have. Does that make sense? Wanting somebody else to tell you what's loving so you don't have to take responsibility for what's loving yourself. Do you see? Whenever we ask somebody else to rule on an issue, we're actually involving them in our decision-making process because we don't want to take full responsibility for the decision we're making, or we feel confused about the decision we're making. The key for you is to just allow yourself to see, well, yes, I must have some fairly large addictions in place with my mother. I'm living in my mother's home. How old are you now, Nico?
31.
So I'm 31 years of age, living in my mother's home. Now, I know this is fairly normal in a Greek household and might even be normal to the man's 40 or whatever, but the reality is that it's helping you not take responsibility completely emotionally for your own life. And it's also preventing you from fully engaging your soulmate longing and also preventing you from fully engaging any emotional issue that prevents you from joining with another woman.
And, Nico, with God. Because at the moment, you want women to fill a hole in you that actually God can heal. And so it's like, for example, if I've got all this grief with my dad, the true way to heal that is to open up and share that with God and let God help take that away from me. If I'm always going to AJ and going, give me a cuddle, give me a hug, give me, come on, make me feel okay, but I'm just avoiding that pain, I'm losing any connection with God and I'm wanting him, it's not even a soulmate longing then.
It's just neediness.
It's needy.
And what you have a habit of doing is projecting a lot of neediness at women in particular, wanting them to respond a certain way. When they don't respond how your mother has responded, then you excommunicate them from your life. You push them out of your life, saying, you're not the woman I'm expecting you to be.
I wanted to talk maybe a little bit about the spirits as well that are influencing the group. But a lot of us have this injury. You're not doing what I want. That means you don't love me. And that's not a truth. But often because we've been raised by people who we don't actually feel a lot of love coming from, but they do things for us to show and say, I love you and this is why I'm doing it. Then we begin to grow in us the injury. Love means doing what I want. Love means taking away my emotional hurt. And the truth is, that's not what love is. True love doesn't seek to take away the emotional pain of another. And love may compel us to do something for someone else, but it shouldn't be in place of love that the act of doing something doesn't actually prove love. And many of us resort to that because we don't feel love for other people, and we don't want to face that, and so we go, oh, I'll do it for you, and we say that's love. And so then whenever we're confronted in our adult life with someone who doesn't do what we want, we go, oh, they don't love us. And that's not actually the truth. Yeah.
On Monday night, we went out to dinner with a group of people, and we sat down and we had another couple rock up and sit next to us. And one of them was a woman, and she was sitting right next to me, and she starts putting things on my plate to eat. Now, I never asked her to put things on my plate to eat. And in fact, what she was putting on my plate to eat, I didn't actually want to eat either. But she just kept putting things on my plate to eat. And I was saying no. I was saying no to her, don't do that. And she still kept putting things on my plate to eat, right? Still kept putting things on my plate to eat. What I'm illustrating by that is often what was coming from my soul at that point is, you're an angry woman who's allowed to control me. That was coming from my soul. So even though I'm saying no, what she's feeling from me is, I'm allowed to get away with this. Right, and what she's feeling inside of herself is, I'm allowed to get away with browbeating a man to eat more food, you know, because I think he's too skinny, you know, or whatever reason she has for that.
Well, but the story she tells herself, though, is something different, isn't it? Mm. I'm loving this man. I'm being generous to this man. Here, have some food. This is how I show love.
And I'm saying no, and I'm actually feeling it as a control and a manipulation, which is very, very different to love. Yeah.
I just had a feeling about the spirits that are involved in this interaction, and I think it relates to a conversation that we heard earlier today about common injuries that I just started to talk to Nico about what love means. And we had a discussion on the ferry on the way back about some injuries that are very prominent all over the world, but in Greece, we notice them, especially in many people here.
If I can just point out as a sort of an introduction to it, every single culture has its own specific emotional injuries that have been culturally transmitted from generation to generation. So don't feel that we're sitting in Greece talking about being here in Greece, of course, but the reality is that every single culture has groups of emotional injuries. So you can go to England and you'll find a whole group of emotional injuries that pervade society. You can go to Australia and find exactly the same, a group of emotional injuries that pervades that society. You can go to Scandinavia, you can go to China, you can go to Japan, you can go to the USA, and any country you go to will have a group of cultural injuries that is passed from generation to generation down through the culture, but also through the spirits who connect to the next generation. So once the spirits pass, they start influencing other people, and that affects the next generation in that particular culture.
And I was just going to ask Arthur and Katerina if you would be happy for us to share the example of what we spoke about, because I felt it really... is that okay, Arthur? Yep. It demonstrated really clearly what we were discussing. Katerina asked us the question, I don't understand. Arthur, he doesn't process, but I see him receive a truth, and I feel him get it in his soul, and next thing you know, it's in operation in his life. But he didn't cry. Like, what's going on with that, you know?
And Katerina said at the same time, but with me, I receive the truth, I get all upset first, and then I cry, and then it becomes a part of myself. Like, why is it different?
Yeah, why is it different? And we talked about the different childhoods that they had, and how that affects our ability to be open to truth. So Arthur grew up in Albania in a time of a lot of poverty. There was a dictatorship.
Political oppression.
They often didn't have much food. They often were struggling all of the time. His family was not very demonstrative. They didn't hug or, you know, kiss a lot, and not a lot of warmth. At 15, he walked out of his country to try and find something better. He was caught and deported and brought back, and that was like a very hard time for him. And eventually he walked again across the border and found this different life in Greece. Katerina grew up in a family where her dad had some status in the society. So he would be... Is this okay to talk about? Yep. He was able to flash his status to people, and they would do... They would get what they wanted. There was power in that place. She also had a mum who... There was a sort of like hugging and doing things, similar to what we were talking to Nico about, cooking for her, giving her things physically all of the time. There was a lot of talking and an interaction in their family. So how does this translate then to an openness to truth? And it was very similar to me. I grew up in a family where we didn't necessarily have a lot of material wealth, but I was always hugged and I was always told I was a good girl and I was always helped to avoid my emotional self. So I grow up with this feeling of expectation that, no, I'm okay, I'm all right. And when somebody, I meet AJ, someone hits me with the truth and I go, what? You're telling me what? No, I'm a good person. No, what? Oh my gosh. You can't be loving me. You're not making me feel okay. You're not doing things for me. And it's all confronting. And I have to go through what is really the addiction in me. I have to confront the addiction, which is that I'm a good person and I'm all right and I'm very loving. Thank you very much. And I should get what I want in life. With the truth that, maybe that's not loving. Someone who grows up with Archer's experience, he's used to not having everything that he wants. Things he receives are gifts to him because he hasn't had that expectation bred in him over many, many years. And so that leaves us much more open to truth. We don't have a lot of addiction that we have to break through in order to receive truth into our soul. And so that was the example that that we spoke about with these guys. And I watched Katerina really get that truth. But there's just one addition that I would make to that. Did you?
No, I'm going to add to it once you've done.
Do you want to add now?
No. Okay.
The other thing that we spoke about was the Greek culture, and there is a certain feeling amongst many people in Greece that we are the cornerstone of civilization. This is where it all began. You know, we started democracy, we were the leaders in, and so there's a feeling bred into many Greek people from when they're small that, hey, like...
A feeling of entitlement.
We've got it sorted out. We're good people, we're civilized people, we're democratic people, we're all this. And again, that breeds in us this feeling like, no, we're a bit of all right. And if someone comes along and says to us, sorry, there's a bit of an error there. You've got a bit of a demand. It's like, whoa! It's a big feeling like a personal affront. They're actually challenging a false belief that we have inside of us. And that a lot of our blocks to receiving new truth are about the false beliefs that are in the way. Yeah. Go ahead, because I'm sure you'll be more eloquent.
No. What you say is exactly right. And I feel it's often the people who have had oppressive lives that actually have more of an appreciation of gifts than a person than people who have been given things all their life. And so if we've had a life that has been relatively easy in terms of where we've been given things, you know, physically given things, and we now have got to the point where we now almost expect things to be given to us all the time, it's very, very hard for us to start confronting the unlovingness of that particular place. And often we will firstly get angry or upset with the person who's pointing it out to us. Then we go into, you know, what do you mean we're not loving? You know, we start justifying that, well, no, we are loving. How dare you say that we're not? We get upset and angry. We get in a rage with the person who's pointing those things out. But the reality is that most people who are in poverty-stricken locations, who have had very, very difficult lives, accept divine truth more rapidly than people who are less poverty-stricken and have had most of the things in their lives exactly how they want it to be. And when I say most of the things in their life exactly how they want it to be, I don't mean emotionally, I mean physically how they wanted it to be. So in other words, physically I've got a comfortable house, I can go and get a car. I can go, you know, I can get anything I want. You know, around here, pretty much you can go down to anywhere within a kilometre here and get any food you want, pretty much. Like any fruit, vegetables, you know, any breads and olives and any other thing that you want that you get used to eating. And if any one of those things were taken away just for one day, there'd be a feeling of, what? What's going on? You know, why has this happened now? Like, there's this automatic emotion that I'm not getting what I want. What's going on? There must be something wrong with the world now. There's something that's not doing what I want anymore. And that emotional projection prevents us from growing in love, particularly towards God, but also towards other people quite a lot. Whereas a person who comes more from Arthur's background, where they have much more lack in their life, almost everything then that is given to them after that point is a gift. Like it's something they automatically, wow, that's something I really appreciate, and they automatically have a feeling of the gift. And this is where we've got to be very careful, is that if in the Western world in particular, we've grown up having almost all of our addictions met from a very, very young age. And as a result of that, we therefore have grown up not understanding love very well generally, because we see love as getting everything that we want, right? Everything I want getting met. And whenever anything I want doesn't get met, or somebody has the temerity to say to me, oh, actually, what you're wanting now is a demand and that's unloving, we automatically get up in arms and upset as a result of that particular want no longer being met. Whereas a person who comes from a background that's poorer generally is not used to their wants and needs being met, even their needs being met. They're not used to that. And so when their needs or desires get met, they have a lot stronger appreciation for the fact that their desires and needs are getting met. And therefore, they are going to find the assimilation of truth much easier. They're going to also be usually more open to receiving the truth, like receiving the truth about themselves, but also receiving the truth about the universe.
Yeah, and also there's this added thing of the investment in I'm a good person. It's like the analogy between the spoiled child and the mistreated child. Both of them have a lot of emotional injury. But the mistreated child doesn't, they have a low sense of worth. So they're not always, when you offer them truth, they're not always fighting through the addiction that, no, I'm a really good person and you're telling me something bad about me. They are open to receiving whatever feedback, and they're more readily able to recognize that this might help me grow. If the spoiled child has been very heavily invested in, no, you're perfect, you're really good, and they have this, no, they have a feeling of wanting to hold on to the idea that I'm a really good person. And so when you offer truth, then it's a big confrontation of that false belief. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yep.
And I feel in the future you'll see this a lot when the world's economy in particular starts to become more degraded. The more the world's economy becomes degraded, the more and more you'll see the people who have had the expectations will be up in arms, and the people who have had no expectations will be quite relaxed with the process. The people who have the expectations will be upset with the government, upset with the politicians, upset with everybody, blaming everybody else for what's happening, not seeing that it's a collective law of attraction for our soul to deal with a group of expectation-based emotions. They will actually look at it very, very differently, and they'll get very angry and upset with the changes that are occurring. Whereas with a person who's dealt with this emotionally, they're quite happy to go through this change because they don't have these deep expectations that I get everything I want when I want it and how I want it and with whom I want it. They don't have that deep expectation inside of them. Yeah. So we were also reflecting at the time too of how much spirits influence a person who's in expectation in comparison to a person who's in a state of openness towards just receiving a gift. See, when you have an expectation, there is an automatic projection going out of you to the world. You've got to give me what I want. So therefore, any person who gives you what you want, you automatically think loves you. The reality is very different from that. See, most people on the planet give you what you want because they're used to bartering with you. And bartering is not love. That's just a bartering system. Yeah, you know, I'll give you this if you give me that. That's all that is. That's a bartering system. And we grow up believing bartering systems are loving. The reality is they're not. What we need to come to understand is most of the people, if I'm growing up with expectations and I've surrounded now by people who meet my expectations, what I've done is I've created this life, if you like, around me is very much not based on love but based on addiction. And the first person who ever gives up the addiction in that life is going to trigger every single person who's in addiction with them. Does that make sense? Like, so just choosing to be the first person to give up all of these codependent addictions automatically means that every single person around you is going to get instantly upset with you generally, because they are very resistive to dealing with their particular addictions with you. And also in that point, that's the point where heavy spirit influence can be involved, because not only are we in the addiction with the people around us, but every spirit surrounding us is also in this same codependent addiction with us. So in other words, if I have a feeling inside of myself, I'm a male and I have a feeling inside of myself of entitlement. I have a feeling inside of myself that, you know, women should think I'm pretty hot and pretty good. Women should think that, you know, they should do things for me. You know, they should cook my meal for me. They should make my breakfast for me. They should clean my clothes for me. I have that expectation of my mother. And then, you know, when I leave home when I'm 40, and because that's probably when I'm going to leave home with those expectations, depending on how strong they are. And I have that addiction in place with the woman I meet. I'm going to attract the same kind of woman who believes that's what love is, and so forth. Now imagine what spirits are with me. I'm going to have male spirits with me who have exactly the same feelings of entitlement and exactly the same feelings towards women with me, exercising, you know, working their way through the same sort of emotions with women. And I'm going to have women with me who think, yeah, you're pretty hot, we'll give you what you want, we'll try and tee up things what you want. And my life will feel to me as like it's pretty smooth. Now, as soon as I start receiving divine truth and I start having a desire to change, all of a sudden now I'll start attracting different sorts of events, because I'm now going to challenge every single spirit relationship that surrounds me. And every single earth-based relationship that's around me will be challenged with my new concept, which is, my demands are unloving, my arrogant viewpoint as a male is unloving, and so forth. And now the people all around me say, no, that's not right, that's not right. What you were doing before is right, you know, because that's their addiction with me. They want to believe that truth because that's how we had the relationship in the first place. And so every single person surrounding me is going to be automatically challenged by my attempting to change. And that's why change is often very, very difficult, because you've got to slow up yourself and stop yourself and then go in a different direction. But not only that, there's all these spirits around you, all these people around you have all now, they're automatically going to be challenged by your change in direction. They can't help to be, because they've all been in a codependent addiction with you in supporting this viewpoint of yourself. Yeah. Does that make sense? Dionysus. It's on.
Just, yeah.
What is actually the process of processing an emotion? And is it essential for the processing of an emotion to cry? Because I also have been an oppressive background,
yeah.
And most of the truth that I receive it without questioning it much, in terms that it resonates.
Yep.
But I don't feel like crying.
Well, it depends on what emotion, as to what the process is of releasing the emotion. So if the emotion is fear, then crying sometimes will be present, but a lot of times you'll be shaking and so forth. If the emotion is shame, you'll feel this waves of heat passing through you, like, and you'll feel really, really bad with it passing through you, but that'll be another emotion. If the emotion is grief, then crying, of course, is going to be the emotion of grief. So it just depends on what the emotion is as to what the body will do and what you will need to do to release it. The issue we face, though, as males, and particularly males here in your society, is that males in your society are used to flamboyantly displaying the emotion without actually connecting to the emotion.
I didn't get that.
They're used to romanticizing the emotion.
You can feel it, like making a show of being emotional.
When in reality they're not being emotional.
But they're not actually really connected with the...
Just to others to feel that I have the idea of that emotion.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah, okay.
It's a way of giving an impression that you intellectually understand without actually having an emotional understanding of what's going on. So for example, a male in Greece, when he's driving a car, a woman cuts him off and he runs into the back of her. This happened for somebody just this week where they saw an accident like that. And he gets out of the car, runs up to the woman, and off he goes at the woman, right? You know, just really getting upset with her about her cutting him off. Now, he's actually upset about his car, right? And he's upset that his life's been upset by this event. And he's upset the fact that it's now going to have to be fixed. And he's quite upset about a lot of different things. And a lot of times, he was right in behind her before she put on the brakes. And so there was nowhere else for him to go but right up the back of her car. But so his own aggression has created, in some cases, the actual the situation to trigger this emotion. Now, instead of him getting into any grief about his or feelings of my aggression is not a right, you know, what caused this was my own actions. So instead of being reflective about any of those things, most of them say, you're all to blame. You know, it was
seeking for commiserations from other males.
Whenever we're feeling an emotion and at the same time seeking commiseration, we're not processing.
No.
That's where the show begins.
That's the show. That's the facade, the show, you know, wanting to do all the things, you know, show off and whatever. And the reality is the show is the problem. Because if we've got to do stop doing the show and start looking at things more deeply. So if the man in that example that I gave started looking at things more deeply, he'd be going, yes, well, obviously, I was driving very close to the woman in front. You know? Now, that's my emotion of wanting to push her along, wanting to push her, get her out of my way. You know, so that's not a very loving emotion. So he would have to look at what's underneath that. You know,
that's processing.
That's starting the process because he's starting now. So instead of getting all angry and upset, which is all the facade. Now he's starting to analyze the actual reason why the event occurred.
So instead of making it external, he's going, what's in me? What's in my soul? Yeah.
Does that make sense? So instead of attacking others and blaming the others for his feelings, he is now looking and being a lot more self-reflective about the feeling. That's the beginning of all emotional processing. Is to begin being self-reflective. In other words, begin the process of being humble to get to have a look at your own self instead of looking at everyone around you and blaming everyone around you for the event.
May I have another question?
Sure. Well, I haven't answered the previous one completely yet.
Sorry.
But that's only the beginning, though. Right, Dionysus, there's a whole series of events that we need to then allow to occur because we need to firstly see what we're doing, then we need to feel about what we're doing, and then we need to somehow get rid of the emotion that caused us to be unloving or caused the unloving event and actually then accept the truth of the loving event, what we would do if we were loving. So there is a whole process we need to go through, which begins with the intellectual acknowledgement that actually, no, I created this event and there's an emotion in me that needs to be addressed and there's something wrong with me here. When I say wrong, I mean out of harmony with love, with inside of me here. So it begins with that, but it has to go deeper. It can't just go, oh, yeah, I know what that is, and then I know what that is, I know what that is. That won't change much because here hasn't changed, and if here doesn't change, the same event will be created. Through the law of attraction.
So when in the example I was giving with Arthur and Katerina, the things that block God's truth from entering us are our emotional injuries. So for some of us, we don't have big injuries in certain areas, and so we hear God's truth and we go, oh, awesome, that's great. I can connect to that now. But there will be, because none of us are at one with God, and Arthur included, there will be a time when it gets to a truth that he needs to release some deep grief about in order for it to really settle in his soul. It's just that when we grow up with a lot of expectations and demands, it's a lot more traumatic to break them down. And the receiving of truth can feel like a bumpy ride instead of the smooth one. But eventually we all get to grief and pain that has blocked us receiving the truth before now. So there will be crying, definitely.
In your future, there will be crying.
And our truth,
all of us.
But the reality is that, you know, the less demands and addictions we're in, the less of that crying will be facade, you know, will be just a show. or commiseration type emotions, and it will be real emotions connecting with childhood events.
Thank you. But my other question, maybe
you forgot your other question.
No, I don't feel like telling it now.
Yep. Maybe someone else wants. No worries. Yep. Want to go straight to Christina?
Hi. About the other issue, thinking that I'm a good person, I'm a bit confused. I realized this yesterday as well. Sometimes I feel like I'm special, and sometimes I think like nothing, like not special at all.
So the opposite of special.
Yes. Yep. And I woke up this morning a lot with this feeling like, who do you think you are? And kind of think like feeling also spirits around me telling me that.
Yep.
So there's a confusion because my mother was more about telling me that I'm pretty and whatever.
Yep.
And my father actually telling me that I'm as every other person, which is true.
Yep.
But he said it with the emotion that, with the fear that I'm going to get like over my head thing.
Right. So he was always trying to prevent you from being arrogant.
Yes.
And your mum was always saying, no, you're beautiful. No, you're beautiful.
Yeah, princess. Yeah. 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 So sometimes it's confusing what's a deception or what's not.
Yeah.
Could you please tell me like more about this? Maybe?
Sure. You wanted to say something?
I was just going to say, for all of us who've been told we're special, most of the time that has come with the condition that you're special when you're my good girl, you're special when you do certain things. So even though we can grow up feeling like, yeah, I'm special, there's also this heavy feeling within us that I'm only special when I do certain things. Mm. And so there's a lot of grief and oppression actually in that. And underneath those feelings can be, actually, I'm not special at all because I don't want to be, you know, I don't. That doesn't feel like the real me at all. I'm only told I'm special when I'm a fake person, when I'm not me. So you can have the, for myself, like this feeling that I grew up with sort of like I'm special, but actually I have the horrible feelings that I'm completely unspecial inside of me because I knew I was in a fake exchange the whole time. And, you know, my soul knew. And the real feeling was coming from my parents. Unless you're special and a good girl, you're not special at all.
No, but it's more unless we think you're special
exactly.
and a good girl, then you're not special.
So now my parents don't think I'm a good girl at all. And so that brings up all of my feelings that actually I'm a terrible girl. It was so conditional on that, on yes. receiving that projection. So just to know that it's not mutually exclusive. You don't have one without the other. Very often you have both at once. Like okay. I have this sense of I'm special, but only while my parents are giving me that projection. When that's gone away or when I want to have my own life, then I find this other feeling inside me, which is I'm not special at all.
Yeah.
So in answer to your question, though, Christina, about the conflicting emotions, the reality is that a person, if you look at a child who has been brought up in love, has really no consciousness of themselves, negatively or positively, in the sense that they don't say I'm special and they don't say I'm terrible. They just am. They just are. You know what I mean? They don't have any negative viewpoint of themselves, and they don't have any exorbitant viewpoint of themselves either. They know they're the same as all others, but they don't have to be told that. They don't have to be told they're special. They don't have to be told they're nice and lovely and so forth. And also, they're never told that they're ugly or terrible. And as a result of that, they grow up feeling that they have confidence in themselves. But it's not a confidence dependent upon other people's opinion.
They have a sense of self.
Yep.
That's what love, that's the gift of love. It enables a person to develop the sense of themselves, independent of how other people feel.
So let's compare that with your feelings, right? Your feelings throughout the course of a day often cycle from I'm special to I'm terrible to I'm special to I'm terrible and any range in between sometimes, right?
Yep.
So a child who has a good self, a sense of self, wouldn't have this cycling going on. Now, I suggest to you that there's two reasons why the cycling is going on. The cycling is going on is because the primary reason is because you've been very dependent on other people telling you things. Now, because you're also very mediumistic, spirits tell you things. So sometimes spirits tell you, you're pretty good, we really like you, you're a lovely person, you're a lovely woman, so forth, you're pretty and all those kind of things. And then other times spirits tell you to control you, manipulate you in another direction, you're a terrible person, what's wrong with you, why do you think you deserve to know any truth, and why do you, you know, why do you think you deserve love and so forth. And because you're quite mediumistic, and if you think about it, this is very similar to like your mum and dad telling you these things. Does that
yeah,
make sense?
Exactly,
like
that's
just playing out until you heal it. And so the real emotion to heal in this case is you're taking on other people's opinions of you constantly, whether those opinions are your parents' opinions or people on Earth's opinions who you know, or spirits who are with you and their opinions. You're taking on their opinions constantly. When you have a sense of yourself, you will no longer take on anyone else's opinion of you. So in other words, they can tell you you're terrible, but you'll still know you're fine. Or they can tell you you're special and you'll still know, well, no, I'm no special than more special than anyone else, but I'm still fine. Do you know what I mean? Like you won't swing between these different areas because you will have a sense of yourself. So the fact that you swing between these two pendulum points, if you like, of I'm not special and I am special, I'm terrible and I'm special, but and in between, the fact that that happens is because you are not yet having a sense of yourself without other people's opinions being involved. Does that make
yeah,
sense?
Yeah.
And that's the main emotional injury to focus on, the fact that you don't know who you are yet without other people telling you who you are. When other people tell you who you are, then you know.
Yeah.
But you don't know you yet.
Yeah.
And this is a very primary, basic emotional injury that many of us have, particularly when we've grown up in a society which is very dependent on other people's opinion. So in most Western civilizations, and you notice it here a lot in Greece, everything is about show. What is perceived by others is what you are. And so when somebody says, "Oh, you look beautiful," that means you are beautiful, you know. But there's no inside of us. We don't know whether we are. We're just being told from somebody else that we are, and so therefore we assume we are.
Mm-hmm.
And this is one of the major issues we need to work through emotionally: letting go of everyone's opinion of us, whether it's bad. Like many of the spirits around you have bad opinions of you, many of the spirits around you have good opinions of you. What we need to do is let go of all the bad opinions and let go of all the good opinions.
Yeah.
And in the end, once we let go of all of those things, we will start to have a concept of who we are for ourselves. We'll see our own weaknesses, we'll see our own strengths, we'll see our own personality, we'll start to enjoy ourselves more. But we also won't have a life that's dictated by the opinion of others.
Yes.
Does that make sense? And that's a major issue for yourself.
How do I... Is it like a causal emotion or different aspects of it?
Yeah, it is a causal emotion because it's related to how your parents have viewed you.
Yeah.
One parent always telling you not to be arrogant, not to be... And the other parent saying, you're special, you're beautiful, and, and you're getting this wide opinion, and you notice it's the male telling you one thing and the female telling you the other.
Well, male spirits telling me, well, who do you think you are?
Exactly. And it's the female spirits telling you, oh, you're beautiful, you're lovely, and so forth, you
see? It's like they had a fight.
Exactly. They're doing the same thing in the spirit world as what your parents were doing to you on Earth, right?
Mm.
That's the law of attraction working perfectly. And as a result of that, the key for you to go through with the male is that I'm never good enough for the male. I'm always wrong. I'm always got, you know, I always got to try harder. I've always got to be better. He's never going to think that I'm actually, that he's happy with me. And they are the emotions associated with the male side. On the female side, it's I'm addicted. There's an addiction in you of surrounding yourself with females who all tell you that you're good and lovely and nice and so forth, so that you can feel good and lovely and nice. And underneath that is a strong feeling that actually you're not good and lovely and nice as a female.
Mm.
That those females are masking, they're covering over for you.
Yes.
So the key is there's two separate groups of injuries, one group of injuries for the masculine and another group of injuries for the feminine. That if we deal with both, in the end, you'll end up with a feeling of, I don't have to listen to the women telling me that I'm good, and I don't have to listen to the men telling me I'm bad, because I know who I am.
Yeah. So, and this is, I think, maybe this was another question, but now I think it's one, that this is one of big blocks for my progress, mm-hmm. I believe.
Very much so.
Yes.
It's a big problem here in the group in Greece in terms of being very, very invested in each other's opinion of each other. And that causes you to not tell each other truth very frequently. You're very afraid of telling each other truth as a result, because you don't want to upset the other person. You don't want to make them feel bad about themselves. And you don't want them to tell you the truth about yourself that makes you feel bad about yourself. And for the women in the group in particular, there's this feeling of camaraderie where you want to, you know, the women all feel good about each other and the men are the problem. And then with the men, there's this feeling of, yes, the women are all not very intellectually developed and the women are all got, you know, they're too emotional. And there's so in amongst the men in the group. And really, this is the societal things injuries. Being played out in the group, the society injuries being played out within the group. The key is to allow yourself to work through this investment you have in other people's opinion and to be honest and truthful with each other from a condition of love. To be love, you know, desire to love each other mm-hmm. in the group, desire to love each other and care for each other, desire to tell each other the truth, not because you're invested in what happens, but because you love each other and you want each other to grow towards God. You want each other to get closer to your soulmates and you want each other to feel some love in the group itself as well. And the key, like truth, is always going to be loving if it comes from a heart that desires what is best for the other person. If it comes from a heart that's desiring just to attack, then we're better off shutting up and going away and dealing with the emotional reason why we want to do that. Yeah.
But also for people to look at this issue, if I feel angry about something that's happening, what's my expectation and demand here? Rather than, that's unloving, you're being unloving and I'm allowed to be angry. Hang on, what's my expectation and demand? I used to have written in Nico, written in pen, on and stuck on a piece of paper on our wall for, I don't know, like a year. Every loving thing that comes to me is a gift, underlined. You know,
Mary thought it was an expectation.
If I demand and expect it, then I'm wanting the person to fill a gap that's already there within me. And I can't actually receive love as a gift in that place anyway. If I'm always demanding love, I'll receive it and go, yeah, that's what I should get. And it actually negates the beautiful gift that love is within me, because when I heal those voids within myself, someone loves me, I go, wow, that's a beautiful gift. And if someone doesn't love me, I go, oh, okay, that hurt, but I don't have to have an angry response towards them. And it's the expectation that you should be a certain way with me that always breeds our anger. Yeah.
And also, you'll get to a point, even when somebody is unloving with you, you won't actually feel hurt. You'll get to a point when you have compassion for them and understanding, you won't actually feel hurt by their actions towards you at all. Mm. And so instead of being up in arms about their actions, even an unloving person's actions, you'll feel, oh, compassion, you know, an understanding for what they're doing and why they're doing it. Yeah.
Can I ask, like, a question that has to do with my progress? I'm not sure. I feel, besides this special thing, issue. What do you feel is one of my biggest, like, rocks in front of me, like, to make a shift more, like, on the path?
I feel for each person here in Greece and for many in Europe, there's a very primary thing affecting the progress of each person. And that is the strength of their desire to have a relationship with God. There's still almost a thought in many, and this is we notice this in Australia sometimes too. There's still a thought in many that they're listening to the divine love path because they want to grow emotionally, or they want to have a better relationship, or they want to attract their soulmate, or they want to. And there's often a list of different things they want to achieve. But God is not very high on that list of priorities. And I sort of feel that for the majority of people still connected with the divine love path, there needs to be a focus, a feeling that they want as their primary relationship, this relationship with God. What we notice is it's only the people who have as their primary relationship this relationship with God that actually progress through everything. They're the people who, no matter what happens, they still keep progressing. And when the relationship with God is their primary desire, as we talked last night to some of the people who were present, if your relationship with God is your primary desire, then it will show in your day-to-day actions. So, in other words, your day-to-day actions will demonstrate that that relationship is your first passion, is your first desire. Now, the only way that that is ever going to happen is for us to have some kind of desire to get to know God. And that is a developing thing. We can't just all of a sudden hear the divine truth and go, all right, I'm going to make my relationship with God my first relationship. We've got to first know who we're trying to connect to. We've got to find out about God. We've got to find out about God's characteristics and attributes. And it's the process of finding out more and more about God that I feel gets neglected. We've focused many times on our emotions. We've focused many times on our relationships. We've actually, when you think about it, we're actually quite focused from a selfish perspective. In other words, how does this affect me? How does this affect my life? But love isn't based on the selfish perspective. Love is based on a feeling of giving to others. And so therefore, if we focus primarily on our relationship with God and developing that relationship and receiving love, we will also then, as a secondary aspect to that, we will focus on learning to love each other. And last night, somebody made the comment that they didn't know what love is. And I put to them that actually, no, we most of us do know what love is, because we just have to ask ourselves one question, and that is, would I like to be treated how I'm treating this other person? Because if I wouldn't like to be treated in the same way, then obviously what I'm doing to the other person is not loving, right? So if we have those two points of focus, firstly, this relationship with God and developing a feeling with God, you know, being open to feeling God's feelings and being open to give feelings to God, you know, feel the relationship, getting to know God from the environment and the creation around us. But the second thing is also coming to understand love and looking sincerely. Whenever I treat you in a way that I wouldn't like you to treat me, I am automatically now being unloving, and I would need to have a strong desire to solve that problem if I wish to become more loving and progress. Now, remember, progression on the path is all about love. So unless we're progressing in love, it's really pointless doing this.
Yeah, and it's something that I've felt strongly about for a while, because I see, and I might have spoken about this already since we've been in Greece, but I see a lot of people get addicted to this concept of truth and emotions. I'm just telling you a truth. I'm just feeling my emotions. But unless we have this relationship with God and a desire to grow in love as the goalposts, then it can get very circular. You know, we can end up feeding our own addictions and our own ego in this truth-telling and feeling emotions. And for me, I feel it is this desire for God that pulls me through the heart, like the really tough, this hurts, or this. It's the desire for God and the desire to be able to be an expression of love, like God's love on this planet, that pulls me through those really, I can't do this, this is too hard times. And it also is the thing that, as you grow in that relationship, gives you the faith that you can actually get through those times. Like, knowing that God does love you, and lots of us start out not knowing that, and it is something that we have to develop. But once you have even a glimmer of that knowledge, that can help pull you through some really big stuff. Without developing those core things, as AJ says, the relationship with God and the desire to love, it's going to be tough going, it's going to get bogged down, it's going to be difficult to want to see your addictions, because your addictions are the things that make you feel good at this point. It's only once you start experiencing this relationship with God and the beauty of actually loving that addictions start to feel a bit cheap and nasty, you know. But when we start, they're like the good stuff in our life, because that's the level of injury that's on the planet. Yeah.
So.
Thank you.
So I feel those things. And many are sort of more focused on, I want to have a good relationship, or I want to deal with different emotions, or, you know, I feel upset about different things and so forth, or I want to know the external truth, you know, I want to know more about what's happening outside of in the world, spirits and all those kind of things. Now, while all of those things are interesting pursuits, they are not going to help you grow in love very much. It's the growth in love that will change your life. It'll also change how the law of attraction works in your life, because your soul will be in a different point of love and therefore attracting different events. And it will also change how people perceive you and see you. You see, if a group grows in love, more people from the environment will be attracted to that group. So whenever on the divine love path we see a group not growing, in other words, the group just stays the same size pretty much, you get some people come in, some people go, some people come in, some people go, but there's a constant cycling of people, but basically the group remains the same, then it means that there's a law of attraction for that particular group, demonstrating that the particular group is not growing in love yet. Because when that particular group grows in love, the attractions will be much stronger. There'll be people pulled on from all over the place wanting to, through the law of attraction, pulled over all over the place trying to be a part of the group, because they can feel the love that's present in the people in the group. And so if a group of people isn't growing, the first thing to always look at is, all right, we can't be growing in love, because if we were growing in love, there would be a stronger attraction to us as a group. And that's a very good indication that love is not the key motivating factor of the group, but other issues are. You know, there might be codependent addictions being worked out in the group and so forth. Once the group loves and feels a bond of love between each other in the group, you'll find other people will just be like attracted like a magnet to that group, and the group will grow as a result.
And that's something, though, that you can nurture within yourself. Like, you can look at the group and go, okay, we're in a lot of addictions, but how did we even come to be interested in this path? For most of us, it's because we feel dissatisfied with the lack of love around us on the planet. We feel like things aren't working. So there is a desire in us to change that and to grow and to become more loving. And it's almost like you need to, you know, water the little seed that was there that brought you here, because a lot of people seem to get lost in that, you know, okay, it's not working, okay, right, I'm going to go in there. But unless we water the little seed and make the seedling of, oh, I want a different world, I want love, it gets a bit murky and we end up, it's all muddy. Yeah, so...
The reality for most, Christina, is that we want love, but we want everyone to love us first.
Yep.
You know, so we want love, but we want love from everybody else coming towards us. We don't want to have to be the first person who loves without love coming back, you know, and that's the issue that most of us face still.
Yeah. A few months ago, I had a dream where I visited the archangels, and when I reached to Archangel Michael, and the presence was so strong, I had to kneel down, like, oh, yeah. I couldn't stand.
Yeah.
And I asked, what do I need to do? And he said, to open my heart. And I said, how? Tell me, what do I need to do? And he's like, you've done it before. Like, it's something we know inherently,
yeah.
I guess.
Yeah.
And so it's... The seed, you said.
Yeah.
Mary. Yeah.
Watering the seed. Yeah.
A lot of us have a strong blockage to opening our heart, because we want others to love us first to prove that now it's safe for us to open our heart and then to love. But the reality is if we want to be leaders of the world changes in love, we must firstly learn to love others even when they don't love us.
That's and there's the a beauty in that kind of love. There's a beautiful quality to that love.
Yeah.
If you water that seed, that's a strong, pure love. Yeah.